lockdown begins, some say 6 months at most until new water concession agreements are ready. And the bet is Manila Water and Maynila will accept, whether they like it or not, for better or for worse. Our guest this morning says the private companies dropping their collective 11 billion peso arbitral award and caving in will set a dangerous precedent. Is there a win-win solution at this point? Joining us this morning, national scientist, UP School of Economics Professor Emeritus Raul Fabella. Dr. Raul, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Thank you for having me.
So I guess we start with this. You have a research note where you said, and I want to quote, if the government gets away with raping a contract now, what's to prevent a repeat rape tomorrow? Pretty strong words. What did you mean?
Pretty strong, yes, but realistic. Governments have the tendency to encroach into the domain of the market. And when these first encroachments receive applause, governments have the tendency to repeat. Mm-hmm. And the contract, a contract is of course very important, and contracts are very important for government performance, especially in PPP. And if the government can attenuate the claims in the contract by simple ad libitum, then it's going to be a case that it will repeat the same thing. Mm-hmm.
Do you think that this, what the government is doing, is receiving applause?
Yes.
Right now.
Yes. In fact.
From whom?
In fact, the sector has anointed the president as being correct on this issue.
Which
because
sector?
Because of the waiver. Well, a lot of them are, of course, Duterte
and the masses.
Followers.
I mean, his approval ratings.
And the masses, yes. Mm-hmm. The approval ratings, yes.
Would you blame the public, Dr. Raul, for siding with the president when they feel, because it seems like for a consumer it's pretty hard to sympathize with the big water companies when you have no water, mm-hmm. when you're experiencing
Correct.
Shortage.
Correct.
And I know that it's government's job to supposedly create that new water source, it's MWSS, but I mean, when I'm a consumer, at the end of the day, when I look at my bill, it's Manila Water or Maynila that I see on that bill.
You can't blame the public for looking after today and perhaps the day after. But, you know, the record of politicians, especially populist autocrats, is to deliver short-term prosperity at the cost of long-term pain. And this has happened in Venezuela, for example.
Very interesting comparison there. Why Venezuela? The Hugo Chavez, Nicolas Maduro era.
Hugo Chavez, writing on the bonanza of oil experts, mm-hmm. he made profligacy really a virtue. Mm-hmm. And for a while, poor people were lifted out of poverty.
So and he nationalized them.
Yeah, he got a lot of applause for it, even globally.
So what he did at that time, sir, was he nationalized, took over the oil companies, utilities, even commercial entities and enterprises.
So that came along. Mm-hmm. That came along with increasing entitlements to the poor, which is a good thing, if there is money. If there's no money, then that's not going to be sustainable. And that happened because when oil prices collapsed, suddenly there's no money in the till. And on his predecessor, his successor, doubled down on his policies. But to be able to do that without money in the till, it means that you will have to prey on the private sector. It means that you have to have price controls, you have to have expropriation of property, you have to have all sorts of actions militating against the market.
And look where Venezuela is now.
Venezuela, 14 and 15, Venezuela topped the misery index, in the global misery index.
And their inflation.
Inflation is the cumulative inflation from 16 to today is about 53 million%. So it's amazing. It's a hyperinflation of hyper kind. Mm-hmm.
Dr. Raul, aside from the comparison you made between the Philippines now and Venezuela, because we used to be compared, we used to be called the Latin American country in the East.
Correct.
And it seems like you're saying it seems like we're seeing a repeat. Aside from that comparison, you also made mention of PIATCO. In some ways, you compared this to PIATCO. And can you expound on that?
Remember,
the PIATCO, of course, is for the NAIA project. Okay.
During the time of President Arroyo, she wanted to be known as the champion of the strong state, no corruption. And the PIATCO, the Terminal 3 in 2002 was completed, delivered by the contractors. Because of the rumors of corruption surrounding the delivery, the procurement, the president essentially refusing to believe his own committee to study the matter, decided on the nullity and avoidance of the PIATCO contract. Mm-hmm. And this went into international arbitration. And to make the story short, in 2015, our own Supreme Court decided with finality to go with the Court of Appeals decision, which also went with the International Arbitral Court's decision to indemnify PIATCO to the tune of 300 something, for almost $400 million.
That's about 25 billion.
In 2016, yes.
Do you think that will happen in this case? In Duterte's watch, that government will be asked to pay up?
What may happen is that the administration of Duterte itself will dribble the matter, and eventually the next administration after Duterte will have to meet the financial responsibility.
Which was what happened in PIATCO. Pinoy settled that $24 billion.
Exactly.
But when you've got the Duterte administration saying, you know, we did not violate any contract because that contract was null and void to begin with, what do you say to that?
Well, the architect of the privatization was, of course, the president at the time,
Fidel Ramos.
And he has written a letter, and it's a public letter, to the president that the government negotiated in good faith and promised to protect the sanctity of the contract. And on that basis, the bidders were able to negotiate with their banks for financing, and they were able to, in fact, bid aggressively for the concession contracts, which resulted in huge discounts for tariff discounts for the consumers of water.
Because, Dr. Raul, what they're saying is we gave up the sovereignty. The government just gave it away, the right to adjust the rates.
Wrong.
You say that's wrong.
Every 5 years in the contract, there is a what is called a rate rebasing exercise.
Yes.
The performance of the concessionaires is adjudged, and their petition for tariff adjustment is decided on the basis of that performance. Mm-hmm. Now recall that in 2003, the Lopez Group which owned the concession in Manilad, declared bankruptcy. And the reason for bankruptcy is very simple.
The rate adjustment was not approved.
They petitioned MWSS, which is the regulator, for a rate adjustment to recoup 8 billion pesos worth of claims. MWSS refused. Manila at that time exhausted all possible legal venues, including arbitra, to force their claims. Lost. They lost in all the venues. And so the only recourse for them was to declare bankruptcy.
But you know, playing devil's advocate, Dr. Raul, the government will say, okay, we get a chance to tell you to refuse that rate adjustment. But technically, you go to courts and the court side with you, we have no voice. That's what the government might say.
If the court sides with you, you have the say.
Depends who the court sides
with. It depends on the evidence that you bring to the court.
So what do you think should the concessionaires do now? There's a six-month countdown until that new concession agreement is completed and finalized, and you've got Manila Water and Maynilad given a chance to review. I imagine it's going to be a very complicated, and they're in a bind because they're very, as you mentioned earlier, well spread. They have their hands in a lot of industries. So what should they do now? Do they take this government to court again?
At the moment, they probably are prudent to keep their mouth shut and wait and see. Of course, the problem there is that their finances will turn bad because they will lose the bank loans. This is, at the moment, they don't have, government has the upper hand. In the short run, it's always the government that has the upper hand. But that upper hand may be used to jeopardize the future of this country. What I'm saying is, the economic team is doing its level best to improve the competitiveness of this country. You have train, you have build. These are good ideas. But if the hole in the hold of the Titanic is left gaping, these activities, which are pretty good, will be all like rearranging chairs in a Titanic. And therefore, it will nullify a lot of their work. Now, this scares me because we have experience in the past where a very good economic team was marginalized because the president was listening to other people.
Who was this president?
Midnight. Well, you know who he is.
Okay.
His midnight cabinet. And that is also one the reason, of course, that that president got turned out. But.
Dr. Raul, if you were, as a national scientist for economics, if you were to rate the Duterte-nomics, 1 to 10, 10 being the highest, what grade would you give the Duterte-nomics?
Well, if the economics team had their way, this would never, I think, this would
have
probably
happened.
Never have happened.
But where we are now?
And the economics team would be rated 9.
Okay.
But if this hole, as I've said, in the hole of the Titanic is left open, then if you take in, as a, in totality, then they'll probably be rated 4. Because taken together, the competitiveness of this country will just drop like a brick.
And you think that maybe the Duterte government will not be forced to pay up to indemnify the private concessionaires, but it's the next administration who
us
will
in the case of
Piatko, the
like you said,
who can actually kick the can further down the road?
Presidents have the tendency to kick the can down the road, and that is of course one of the problems of our democracy, that responsibility could be passed on to the next administration, but. In the meantime, we will probably use 2, 3, 4 years of very weak investment. And that means we are probably going to go back to the old normal. And the old normal is that we are going to be last in this area, region of the world.
And in the meantime, at the end of the day, the Filipinos will pay out.
In the end, it is the taxpayers who will pay.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Dr. Raul, for joining us.
Thank you.
Great always to have you on the show. Thank you, sir.